Can start. Okay, so yesterday we finished to review semester two and started semester three. We started with the notion of separable algebra object. Okay, so it's an algebra object in which the multiplication morphism split as an homomorphism of A I module, which means that it should satisfy this property, which can be written like that. Associativity. It should satisfy also this property for some delta, this picture, and finally this picture. We show that this two last picture here, but this picture here, is also used in the notion of Frobenius algebra, in which delta corresponds to the coalgebra structure, co-multiplication, with some motivation from subfactor theory. Okay, so in the classical sense, which means taking the category to be vec, as I said also, separable algebra mean absolutely semi-simple, which means that the algebra is semi-simple and any extension coming from field extension keep semi-simplicity. Okay, so what's the point of this notion? The point of this notion is this proposition, saying that if the algebra object is separable, then on the fusion category, then the category of A module is semi-simple. Okay. So here is a proof. So we are still in the review part, so I skip the proof. But you see the proof is in eight step. Okay. So in the above proposition, we have this to be semi-simple, but we know that semi-simple implies exact. So this is automatically exact. And so by definition, a separable algebra object is exact. Okay, so now, what about that? It's match product. So should I skip that? I don't remember the point of this definition. So, okay, let me see. You take a bi-algebra, an algebra object in the representation of this bi-algebra. You can make what is called a smatch product. Okay. So I guess this, so I don't want to go into the details. This smatch product generalized, what is important to understand is the smatch product generalized the notion of semi-direct product. So it's a smatch, so it's a generation of the semi-direct product from group theory here for bi-algebra involving algebra objects in the representation of the bi-algebra, and the details are written here. So as I said, for group, it corresponds to semi-simple product. And this point is that, so the category of A module with A algebra object here is isomorphic to the category of representation of this smatch product. So I guess this smatch product is also a bi-algebra. Anyway, so a new notion involving a module is called internal home in module category. Okay, so you consider a multi-tensor category. And we assume it to be finite. You take M to be a C-module category, M1, M2, two objects in this module category. And you consider the following functor from C to VEC, so the kind of home space functor, functor on home space of the, on the module, like that. Okay. So the module is a left module, okay. So this functor is left exact because it can be written as a composition of left exact functor. And why the components of this composition are all left exact? Because the category is assumed to be multi-tensor. Okay. And the fact that this functor is left exact implies that it is representable. So it's a usual notion in category theory, representability of the functor. Here, so representable means the following. So there is an object. So this is an object. This is not the home space. It's just a notation for an object in this category. And there is a natural isomorphism from this here to this. So it can be so this can be represented here involving this new object. So there exists such an object with which we can represent this here, like that. Okay. So one advantage to assume finite is that this object exists directly in this category. Otherwise, you should use inductive limit. So it may not exist in general, but it exists up to inductive limit. And such an object is called internal home. So yeah, this is a kind of technical object which really use a lot in the proof. Also. Okay. So internal home from M1 to M2. So it's a bit of abuse of notation because it's not a home space. It's an object, but we will see later what we can do with that. Okay, so so if you consider the module, if you consider the module category and its opposite, you can make a bifunctor, opposite M cross M to C, like that, involving the internal home. So this exercise is to show that it's a bifunctor. And it's left exact in both variables. Okay. So here are the interesting property of the internal home. In fact, the main motivation for introducing such object. So the first one is by definition. So this is how we define that. But then you can deduce all the other. So here we are home in M. In C, so what's the difference here? Okay. So, yeah. The idea is to group together every M1, M2. So here you have, you move this one here and you get this. Here you move this one here. So it remains only one, but you get this. Here, you I may um, here the point is that you can put this x outside. Be it outside, yeah, but you have to put a draw. Okay. So we skip the proof. Okay, so adjunction isomorphism. Ioneta lemma. Etc. So, okay. So now you fix an object M in a C-module category M curve. You consider the functor, this functor, like that. And so this corollary states that this functor is a C-module functor. It's not just a functor, but it's a functor of C module, considering C as a C module here. Okay. Okay, now. So you take the C module M to be, you assume it to be exact. Then the bifunctor like that is exact in each variable. Okay. So here it's a functor one variable. Okay. Okay, so now you take two C module categories. You assume the first to be exact. And so any additive module functor from the one to two is also exact. Okay. So some technical property. Consider a kind of converse of this proposition involving internal home. So I guess I'm. And this proposition is a converse of this one. So here we have this is exact, imply that any additive module functor is exact. So take a finite multitensor category, you take a C-module functor such that this bifunctor is exact in the second variable, which means that this functor is exact, and then this M is exact. Okay. So what's the relation with that here? Yeah, M1 is exact. Here, M1 is assumed to be exact. And here, we deduce M to be exact. Mm-hmm. And more generally, you fix two non-zero C module categories. And you assume, okay, now this is really the converse here. You assume that every C module functor like that is exact, then this must be exact. And what about the additive? So I guess C module functor, yeah. C is a multitensor category, so C module functor is automatically additive. Okay. So, okay, so here is a proof. So again, I mentioned that for people who do not follow every course, I am in the review of the semester 3. So I skip the proof because it's a review part. I need to be quick. But of course, when I will start new material of semester 4, I will do most of the proof. Okay, so okay, now you take a multi-tensor category, you take an algebra object. Oh, sorry, I'm lost. Where am I? Here. Okay, a multi-tensor category, an algebra object, and two A module. Okay. It's complicated here. So, as remember that A module are internal home. Okay. So, I forgot the definition. Internal home, let me go there. Internal home. Okay. Two objects, M1, M2. Just two objects in. Ah, okay. Two objects in a module category. So where is it? Okay. Ah, okay. So you have an algebra object. You have this module category, and you take two objects. So you have, it's a specific case of module category. But we saw that in some good case, every module category can be written this form. So in this case, this object is nothing but given by the relative tensor product. So M relative tensor product over A of the right dual of N, left dual. So what's the point of that is to show that you, in the good case, you can write this missed, this tricky home, internal home, completely explicitly. Okay, so this may be denoted like that. So with A index on top. And the second exercise is to deduce that the exactness of A is equivalent to the pi exactness of the internal of the relative tensor product on bottom or on top. Okay. So now what about making we will consider tensor product of internal home. Okay, so you consider a multi-tensor category C, a C module category, two objects in the C module category. So we have a canonical evaluation morphism. I see. So here you play, in some sense, you simulate this to be as a home space, because you fix that and you fix one thing here, so one entry, one input, and you get an output in some sense. So you simulate that to be an home space, but it's not an home space, it's an object. So how to do that? So this evaluation morphism is obtained as the image of identity morphism on this object under the following natural isomorphism. Coming from the definition of internal home. Okay, so this comes from the definition of internal home. And here you put X to be also an internal home. So for to avoid any confusion, I wrote just X inside. Yeah, you really see the definition of internal home. And you put this X here. So you see now the identity lives here, but you have this natural isomorphism here. And so this is exactly, this is an element here. So via this natural isomorphism, you can map such morphism to a morphism like that. And this is the definition of this morphism. Okay. Take three objects in the C module category and you consider composition. Okay, so what about that? I see. So you have, you consider this tensor product of two objects. And here, this corresponds to the evaluation map. So you have two possibilities. So here, you take the associativity constraint to move the parenthesis, and then you can apply the evaluation map here. So you got here, and you can again apply the evaluation map, and you get here. So it makes sense to write such tensor product in this order, M2, M3, M1, M2. You should not put this here to get what you can intuitively expect, M1, M2, M2, M3, but it's according to this definition of canonical evaluation map we use. In fact, you have the M1 here like that. So anyway. Maybe there is a more convenient way to do that if you put the M1 here. Anyway, it was written like that in the book. So, okay. So now. So you have that, okay. So you have a map from that to that. Now, if you apply again this natural isomorphism from the definition of internal home, but now with X equal to that, you get a morphism like that. So wait, sorry, what's the point? I see. Wait. Wait. I see. You apply the inverse. In fact, you go from here to here because we already made this one from here to here, which corresponds to that. And you apply this natural isomorphism and you get something from that to where is it? Like that, from that to that. Okay, so you apply the previous isomorphism, but in the other way. Okay. And so you can see this is a simulation of composition of morphism. This is an object. There is no morphism here. But you can simulate via this morphism like that. Okay, so assuming the C module category to be of this form, then this one can be written like that. Okay, as just an immediate translation. Okay, so we can also make a canonical unit morphism. Okay, so it's by taking M1 equal M2 equal M, you take X equal 1, so the X here. M1 equal A2 equal M, X equal 1. And you get something like that. And so the unit morphism will be the image of the identity of M. Okay. So we made a lot of ingredients. And now I guess we will state something. So to associate this multiplication morphism here is associative. Ah, okay. I guess we will go to an algebra object if M1 equal M2 equal M3. Look like that. Compatible with a unit. And okay. So in particular, for every object in a C-module category, this object has a canonical structure of algebra object here. As I just mentioned, you just take that equal that M1 equal M2 equal M3. And you use all these ingredients we found. Every object, and you can make also module over, so now you take M and N, and this is a module over this algebra object. So it's a good way to make this internal home tool is a good way to make new algebra object and new module. This functor, so you have our algebra object now. So we can consider the category of module over this algebra object. And you consider this functor involving this point, M like that. And this functor is a C module functor. Okay. So what is 3? 1, 2, 3, 4. Prove in previous. 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, it's very far. It's too far. 1, 2, is it that? No, maybe that. I don't remember. Maybe this one. Maybe this one. I guess it's what I refer for 1, 2, 3, 4. Is that. Okay. Okay, so we have a good model of object, algebra object, and module over algebra object involving internal home. I expect it's more or less canonical, in fact. Every object in the good case can be written like that. Algebra object, okay. I see. So now this is very, very important because we will prove that we will state, we proved the last semester, but we will state in this review that this C module functor here, C, F, is an equivalence of category. In the good case, in some good case. Okay, so which means that every C module category is of the form or equivalent to that, which is what we expected. So you see, in some good case for M, and when I say good case, it's really, it's not so much. It's really the usual case you consider. For example, if I know, I don't know if you are for fusion category. Or in the usual good case, this module category is equivalent to this module category, where M here is just anyone given. In fact, there is no, we can take any object in M, in fact, I guess. So it's always equivalent to that. So it's always of this form. Okay. I see. Okay. So now, so you take two multi-tensor categories. You take a tensor functor between these two multi-tensor categories. Recall that this tensor functor induces a structure of C module on D using this tensor product. Okay, so now you take the right adjoint of this tensor product. You take the unit object in the multi-tensor category D, and then the image of any object Y in D is isomorphic to the internal home one Y. So you see how general it is. You take any tensor functor of any multi-tensor category. So this is very general. You take the right adjoint, and then the image is given, is equivalent of an object, is isomorphic to this internal home. So you see how important is this notion of internal home, because in such big, in such generality, it appears. Okay. And I guess you see some, we are playing with adjoint. So I guess this will involve, at some moment, we will see appear the definition of internal home here. Okay. So if you take y equal one, you take, you have that, which is an algebra object, because one, you have two the same. And now you consider this functor. Okay. So now you have, so this is a module over this object. And so you have this C module functor here. Okay. And so this, I guess, according to what we said before, in the good case, D as a C module category will be equivalent to that. So example, you consider an finite dimensional of algebra. So this is for C representation category of a finite dimensional octahedron. And for D, the trivial category, the trivial monoidal category, so VEC. And here, a monoidal functor. So to VEC, what? Tensor functor. Not just monoidal functor, but tensor functor. To VEC, so it's a fiber functor. So I'm lost here. So remember, fiber functor used for in the chapter about of algebra reconstruction theory. Okay. So here one is the field K. So here it states that this algebra object is the dual of algebra. So viewed as an algebra object of this category, where the Hopf algebra act on its dual by left translation. In fact, the dual of the dual is isomorphic to H. So H is a dual of it. So you have an action. Okay. So it's quite concrete. Now, you consider a multi-tensor category as a C Delin tensor product C of module category. Remember that this is a generalization of action by conjugation of a group. Then you take what will be called canonical algebra. So be careful. Here, one and one are object of C as a C Delin tensor product C op module. So this is an object here. The problem with this notation, so it, this notation don't say that where in which category it is. So it can be a source of confusion. So this is called the canonical algebra of C. Okay. So it's a name, even if it is not in C. But you see, this C as a module category over that will be equivalent to the A module category like that. So it is, yeah. Sorry. So it's, so it represents, in some sense, this category. Okay, so now so example, so if you consider the previous example, so previous example, so A is still, so if you apply the previous example in this case, you take C equal category representation of algebra, A is still as a dual of H because, okay, so it's a dual of H, but as an object here. And remember that object, this category is equivalent to the category of C by module. So we already mentioned that. So in this case, for this example, apply here, the dual of H is considered as an algebra object in the category of H by module. Before it was an Azure object in the category of H module. Okay, so I see. So now the point is to write this object explicitly. We will see later that this category will be related, not equal, not the same, but related to the Drinfeld Center. So we will see the relation between that and the Drinfeld Center very soon. But for now, let us explain how to write this object, algebra object, explicitly. So here we assume fusion case, multi-fusion category. You consider that to be the set of simple objects up to isomorphism. You consider the canonical algebra object as defined before. Then it is isomorphic to the direct sum over the simple object up to isomorphism of X, the linear tensor product, right dual of X. So remember the definition of the linear tensor product. The object in the Deligne tensor product are of this form. So this is not a tensor product inside a category. This is the symbol we use to define the Deligne tensor product. So, okay. So you see how explicit this algebra object can be written. Okay, so the proof. So you see this kind of proof in this chapter. Most of the proofs reduce to some natural isomorphism involving Ohm space. I will mention Yoneda lemma also, but it more or less reduced to that natural adjunction isomorphism, etc., etc. So the sum appear here. So where X appear for the first time, X appear here. Yeah. Okay. So it's a kind of decomposition here. Anyway, so so what about, there is also a way to write equation. Okay, so we wrote explicitly up to isomorphism this algebra object. Okay, now what about the multiplication morphism on this algebra object, and we can also write it explicitly. In fact, the tensor product of this algebra object with itself is isomorphic to that. Next, so let me see. So let me do that after the pause. I will make the pause now. Okay, so what I said, yeah, the explicit multiplication morphism on this canonical fundamental algebra object. So we consider pairing. So we want something from A tensor A to A. So we consider a pairing. Okay, so what about this pairing? So this is take a morphism here. So I guess it's not a tensor product. So wait. So let me fix that. I expect it's not a tensor product. I hope I'm not mistaken. Okay. So you go from that to that, and then you compose from that to that. So you get a scalar. You get the morphism from that to that. So it's a scalar in the simple case. If Z is simple. Wow. Z is a simple object. Okay. So you consider that now you have this natural isomorphism. Okay. So we get confusing here. Get this map. So wait. I'm confused about that. Should be the lean tensor product? Should it be what? I guess no. Okay. So what we want should be a direct sum over the simple object of such morphism. Consider a canonical morphism in above. Okay. So a direct sum of such morphism because we are written like that. So we are looking component by component. Like that. I see. So when you make a direct sum here, what you get is exactly A. And when you do a direct sum here, what you have is A tensor A. So by making some direct sum, you get by making sum of such morphism here, you get a morphism. You can make a morphism from that to that. Okay. Okay. Wait. Anyway. Now. Characterization of module category in terms of algebra object. Characterization of module category in terms of algebra object. Okay. So you consider. You take a six module category. You consider this the category. So you take the algebra object Ohm, internal Ohm MM. I see. And so you consider this six-module category of this form for, as we see before. So we see. So I guess we will explain that in more details in this section. In particular, we will explain what good means. So C is assumed to be finite multi-tensor category. You take a C module category, you take an object such that this functor is exact. So we already mentioned that this functor is automatically left exact. So we only need to assume it to be right exact. We assume also for all objects in the module category, there exists an object in the category C such that X tensor M map surjectively to N, which means that the object M generates the full category M as a C module category. So you see, for a good definition of generate, for example, when you consider the all the components, for example, you take you fix this object M and you make this action by object of C and you reach everything up to taking the component, I guess, at least in the semi-simple case. So this is the meaning of generate. Or you have that. You can. But intuitively, it's more intuitive to say generate up to taking component. So it's in some sense it's it's okay. The orbit, if you think in terms of a group, you can think like transitive action or single orbit. Anyway. Okay, so you assume these two things for this object. Now you consider this algebra object here. Then, so we state the theorem we mentioned before. Then this functor we already defined before is an equivalence of C module category. So what was the good case here? The good case here is first C to be a finite multi-tensor category, and also to assume the object M to satisfy that. So maybe that may be relaxed later, I don't remember. So, okay. So under this good assumption, we only need to represent this C module category like that. We only need the existence of a single one object satisfying this property, and then you automatically have an equivalence of C module category. Okay. So let's give the proof. Wow, the proof is very long. Wow. So this theorem is not at all obvious, as you can see. So if you're interested, you should watch the video of last semester where I explained that in more details. Ah yeah, I remember it. Yeah. Five lemma theorem. So it's a very usual lemma in category theory, very general. Well, this is not about the category here, it's completely purely categorical I guess maybe abelian category or something like that. Wow. Not finished. The proof is not yet finished. Where is the end of the proof? Okay. The proof, the end of the proof is here. Wow. So it's a big 1, 2, 3, 4 slide to prove this this theorem. So this is really important. Now the question is, in which case, I don't remember if we will treat this question after that, but in which case, for which C-module category, such an object exists? If I'm not mistaken, we will discuss that now. At least provide some example. So, consider the multitensor, the finite multitensor category as a C-module category on itself, so called regular C-module. Then, for all objects, non-zero objects in this C as C-module, the internal home is nothing but given by tensor product and left dual. So internal home XY is Y tensor X star. Yeah. And in fact, as I wrote here, this example will be more relevant before when we introduce internal home, in fact. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, you apply the previous theorem to, we can apply the previous theorem to M equal X. So you fix M equal X. Here, algebra object is X tensor X star, and you see here, we recover the canonical, the first general algebra object we mentioned when we introduced the definition of algebra object. We said X tensor X star, which is, remember, generalization of matrix algebra. And you recover it as an internal home algebra object for the C module, for C as a C module. Okay. And then you apply the previous theorem, so that equal to that. And so you have C as a C module. You take any X, in fact. I guess you can take any X, I will not go, it's too much slide. But I guess as long as X is non-zero, so any X you choose can satisfy all the assumptions. If I'm not mistaken, this kind of exactness of functor, and the transitivity, you have the thing with the orbit as it generates with the epimorphism, surjection, something like that. So, okay, I guess, yeah, you take X equal one and it's trivial. So, you see, yeah, exercise, you check that. So, you see, for a finite multitensor category, it can, as a C-module on itself, it's always equivalent to that under this equivalence of category involving tensor product and the dual. Okay, so okay. I see. Yeah. Here we discuss in general some sufficient conditions to have this assumption 1i and 2i in the previous theorem. If the module category is indecomposable as a C module category, and the object you take is projective, then the assumption I hold. So this is exact. More or less, so similarly, if this is indecomposable exact C module category, any non-zero object work. Okay. So I guess the previous case, this case here, we are in this here. I guess C as a C module category is indecomposable exact. If I'm not mistaken. And finally, about the point two, the point number two is equivalent to the fact that the class of the object M in the Grothendieck group, seen as a Z plus module of this Grothendieck ring, this class is this class generates again orbit transitive assumption, something like that. Cyclic, I guess the good word is not orbit, is not transitive, but cyclic. It's a cyclic object, cyclic element. Yeah, the cyclic element, because at least in fundamental algebra, we use this kind of cyclic vector. Okay. Anyway. Cyclic, because a single one generates everything. It's not a cyclic group, of course, but you understand the idea. Singly generated, yeah. As a module. Yeah. Okay. So, corollary. If the C module category is finite, then there exists a C module. There is an algebra object making it equivalent to the category of A module. There exists an algebra object A making it equivalent to the category of A module. And I guess we will use the previous theorem and this property, this result. Finally, so you consider an indecomposable exact algebra object in a finite tensor category. So remember, an algebra object is called indecomposable exact if this is an indecomposable exact C module category. Show that it is always of this form. I see. So every indecomposable exact algebra object in a finite tensor category can be isomorphic to something like that. So in this good case, in fact, the algebra object reduced to a internal home model. So you take for this C module category, where you take just M equal F. Okay. So you have an algebra object. You can make a C module category like that. And you take here M equal A. And you have the model you want. Okay. Now. Category of module functor. Categories of module functor. So, you consider a multi-tensor category C. You consider two C module categories, M1, M2. Recall that the category of C module functor between M1 and M2 can be can be very hard. That's why, even for the trivial case, that's why we need to assume some exactness property to make the classification of such C module functor workable. Here we consider the full, in the sense of home space, subcategory of right exact C module functor from M1 to M2. Denoted like that. M1, M2, multi-tensor category. So you assume M1 and M2 to be returned by the usual model for some algebra object. So as we see before, in the good case, it's always possible. So here we assume it is possible for this M1, M2. Some algebra object, okay. Then this category as defined here is equivalent to the category of AB by module. Okay. So this is an AB by module. And here, by using the tensor product relative to A, so it's left by module, left on the, it's left here for A. Here you have a functor from M1 to M2. So you take someone in M1. So you make relative tensor product M by module. So you put some M1 here, an object of M1 here, and what you get should be an object of M2. Because here you have B and M2 is of this form. So I guess it is. Wait. So module category. Okay. This is a B module. So when you put an element of an object of M1, this has a structure of B module, so it's here. Okay. So, via this equivalence of category, this equivalence of category make this an abelian category. Okay. Now. So here we fixed right exact, but we can do the same with left exact, but we have to replace this by this. Anyway. Um, in general, this category m1 equal m2 equal m, so the category like that is a monoidal category. Where the tensor product is given by composition, but it's not rigid. Okay. Okay. So in general, if you just assume right exact, you get a monoidal category, but it's not rigid. If you want to get something rigid, you have to assume exact, not just right exact. Okay, so now you take three exact C-module categories. Yeah. This category is additive category of C-module functor, which is automatically exact by the exactness of M1. Okay, and so you can prove that any object here is of finite length. The bifunctor is by exact. Any functor here has a left and right adjoint. Okay, and map projective object to projective object. Okay. And if C is a finite multi-tensor category, because it was only assumed to be multi-tensor category, so if you assume finiteness, then it's also finite. Okay. Okay. Okay, okay. So there is no application of that. So it's just an exercise. Okay. So you see, this is what we wanted, something finite. Remember, but we said, in general, without exactness, even for the trivial category, you have something huge. But under this, the conclusion is that, it's finite. Under this assumption, you have something finite, and this is what we wanted to get. And finite, in fact, is all this. Finite. You have some finite lengths. Yeah. So in this good case, you have something finite. So this is what we wanted to have. If you assume exact, right exact, which is completely exact because both are exact. In this good case, exact, this is finite. Okay. Now, dual tensor category and categorical Morita equivalence. Aha. So now we start some important notion, and we are closer and closer to the notion of Drinfeld center. In fact, the notion of Drinfeld center is closely related to Morita equivalence. Okay. So you take the multi-tensor category. You take exact C module category. So remember, we care about exactness everywhere, but if we are in the semi-simple case, everything is exact. So of course you can have a semi-simple, we have to be careful when you talk about semi-simple. What about it can be the the category, which can be semi-simple, or the module category, which can be semi-simple, but one can be semi-simple and the other can be not semi-simple. So, but at least if the module category is semi-simple, it's automatically exact. Anyway, so but if for a semi-simple category, the module category are not automatically exact. Remember, the trivial category is trivially semi-simple, but the module are not trivially are not always exact because, as you, as we said, we have this huge category of functor of C-module functor, even in the trivial case, which is not huge if you assume exact, which means that anyway. Yeah, for C trivial, in fact, the C module functor are all the abelian categories. So they, obviously, they may be obviously not semi-simple in general. Anyway, so you consider two exact C module categories and you consider a C module functor. F, you consider the right adjoint of F, denoted G, and we induce a module structure on the adjoint using this natural isomorphism. Okay. So here you have natural adjunction isomorphism. Here, adjunction isomorphism from the adjoint. Okay. So you start, and here you use the fact that F is a C-module functor. Okay. So C-module functor here, of F, the adjoint are used here. And no, only here and here, and the natural adjunction isomorphism here. And so you get so something from that to that. So something to put out the X, so to get a. Module structure on G. Okay. So idem for left. Here is right. Idem for left adjoint, I guess. Okay. So we have C module functor structure on the right adjoint of a C module functor. So here we need to show that the right and left adjoint are right and left dual in this category, in this monoidal category. Remember, this is a structure of monoidal category, and this is a category of functor, and the left and right adjoint of C-module functor, the left and right adjoint here are seen as dual. So both have, they all have right and left dual, so the category is rigid. By definition. Okay. And this can be proved using F. So you, by defining evolution and coevolution map like that involving F and its adjoint G, like that. Okay. Okay. Now, yeah, I remember that this is nice. So we will use this definition a lot. So, definition, you consider an exact C-module category on a finite multi-tensor category C, and you define the dual tensor category to C with respect to M, dual tensor category to C with respect to M. And we will see that, I guess, it is more equivalent to C later. So, this is the tensor category defined like that. So we saw it's a monoidal category, it is rigid, and it may have, as we mentioned before, all the structure to be a tensor category. So here, C is assumed to be a tensor category, not just multi-tensor. No, multi-tensor, okay. Dual tensor category. So I have a doubt, maybe C should be a tensor also. Or it would be the dual multi-tensor category to C with respect to M. I don't remember. Does that matter? You can assume tensor everywhere. So the dual tensor category to C with respect to M. So it is the M is an exact. So it's a category of C module functor between M and itself. This category has a structure of monoidal, rigid, blah, 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 category. It's a tensor category. And it is denoted the dual tensor category with respect to M. So it's interesting. Interesting to make new category. You have a category C, the tensor category C. You are interested in the exact C module category. And from each exact C module category, you can make a new category. And we will see that, in fact, this new category is not so new because it is more equivalent to C, if I'm not mistaken. So we will mention that soon. So, I am completely stupid. What I was confusing, it's written just here. So by the previous, we said dual tensor category, but in fact, it's a multi-tensor category. So this is a finite multi-tensor category, and it's a tensor if and only if the module functor is module category is indecomposable. Okay. So that's very interesting. In fact, that's very interesting. Very important. Okay. So you consider M. So you consider M not necessarily indecomposable. So you consider a decomposition into indecomposable. You consider the projection functor to the component. Okay. So the direct sum of this projection functor can be seen as the unit is, no, no, can be seen, but is the unit of this multi-tensor category. And each one here is simple here. So you see this component as a subcategory of M. So in fact, this functor can be seen as from M to M. So it can be seen. Okay. So a lot of new concept. In fact, it's quite dense. This book is very dense. So example, you take a multi-tensor category and you consider As usual, module category on itself, the regular one. I need to do something. Every C module functor from C to itself is of the form. So every C module functor from C to itself is of the form of the tensor form. So let me check. Okay. Yeah. And in this case, so I guess this is something we already seen before. And in this case, the dual tensor category to C with respect to C is tensor equivalent to the opposite category. Okay. And okay. Now you take an algebra object, you take this module category, then the dual, I don't remember the dual tensor category to C with respect to that is tensor equivalent to the opposite of the B module category, the AA by B module category. Okay. So that's important. What time is it? I guess it's almost the time I always forget. So let me finish with this lemma. So this, in this case, this module category, the module category M over that is exact. What does it mean? What is M? M is that. A is some algebra object in general. So M is exact on that. So I guess it's not exact on C, but it's exact on the C, on its dual with respect to itself, with respect to M. Okay. So you write this like that. So the projective object, so it's two. It's just a sketch, it's not understandable in 10 seconds. Okay, so the proof is here. I have no time to, in fact, I skip the proof. Yeah, so it's okay. So we will stop here.